All right, so now we're shifting to a discussion of some early Christian thinkers. We're going to talk specifically about St. Augustine and St. Thomas, Thomas Aquinas. And generally speaking, these two really, and they are competing narratives, these two individuals really have the same goal, that at the time of Augustine, what we find, and give you some dates here, at the time of Augustine in Rome, you have a conflict occurring, and the conflict is between the ideals of the ancient Greeks, right, which Rome had almost totally adopted, and the ideals of early Christian theology. So as Rome becomes a Christian empire, right, you have these competing beliefs. So so the first thinker we're going to look at, St. Augustine, he's the bishop of Northern Africa. He attempts to eliminate or to nullify the conflict between the ideas of the pagan Greeks like Plato and Christian theology. So that's what he sets out to do. And St. Augustine is uniquely positioned to do this because he is not born into Christianity. He's born a pagan and converts later in life. So and it's this conversion story of Augustine that becomes his most most well-known work. So we'll see the same thing happening when we get to St. Thomas, that the works at the time of Aquinas, you have hundreds of years of Christianity being a very Platonic, or some of the fundamental ideas being uniquely Platonic. And so at the time of St. Thomas, we see the works of Aristotle being translated out of the Arabic and back into Latin. And so a conflict comes up or arises again, that you have this ancient Greek philosophy and competing values, or so they think, in Christian theology. So Aquinas is doing the same work as Augustine in terms of trying to end this dispute between religion and philosophy, specifically Christianity and philosophy. So, and the philosophy of our ancient Greeks. So they both have the same goal in mind. They just simply use. So Augustine, for instance, is considered a Neoplatonist because he is able to do this work on, well, we might say, on the behalf of Plato, but in order to integrate or to make sense of the Platonic ideas, Aquinas is doing the same sort of thing, but he's doing so with the ideas of Aristotle. So this chronology here, it's a very brief chronology, it's just to give you kind of an idea of where we are in history. So you see that we get the rise of Christianity as religion of Rome with the conversion of Emperor Constantine. And to give you a little context in terms of the theological history, we don't see a full and complete New Testament to the Bible until around 300 AD. There's Augustine, and you see where he is in terms of the development of Christianity, that St. Augustine is, you know, is really right there, if we can say, on the cutting edge of Christian theology, whereas it'll be, you know, 900 years later before we see St. Thomas on the scene. So St. Augustine, as I said, his important work, his confessions, were about his conversion from a pagan Roman to Christianity. And so, what is the connection between early Christian theology and the ideas of Plato. What sort of work is Augustine doing in trying to end this dispute between philosophy and Christianity? So, the first concept that Augustine looks at is this idea of Platonic dualism, right? Recall that Plato says there are two realities, essentially, right? There is that physical, sensible reality that we deal with every day, and then there is a super sensible reality, a reality that is beyond this one, and it's a reality that we cannot get to with our physical bodies. So think about how revolutionary the idea of two realities is, and how significant this dualism is to Christian theology, the idea that there is a realm that is beyond the physical realm. And not only is it beyond the physical realm, right, but that second level of reality, that upper level of reality is what's important and what's true, that this reality is not as good, it's imperfect, whereas that other reality is permanent and doesn't change, right? Which is exactly how Plato describes formal reality. Secondly, if you think about Plato's theory of forms and his highest form, right, which is beauty, unity, that Augustine says, or looks at this and says, well, this isn't really different from that what, you know, essentially what Plato is describing. These are aspects of God, right? So when we think about the characteristics of God, often we talk about God being all good, God being the beginning and the end, oneness, right? Unity. So Augustine says, well, look, see, these ideas, these are actually the characteristics of God. So for Augustine, right, Plato's highest form is essentially a description of of God. Also, if you recall, Plato took the position that the human soul was that perfect form of the individual human, right? That it could possibly be immortal, right? But you know, this conception of the soul as the real you, right? The capital T true you, right? That you are not reducible to your physical body. That what's true about you is the soul, right? So this idea of the soul in Christianity is a very Platonic conception of the soul. And lastly, and most importantly, Augustine takes his conception of evil from Plato. Now, Plato didn't necessarily talk about it in these sort of moral terms, right? Evil being wrong, bad. But for Plato, right, that this world, right, the reality we live in that we experience through our senses, is less valuable than the next world because, if you recall, everything in our reality is changing, right? What's wrong with it? Why is it bad? It's bad because it's impermanent, it's temporary, right? That the focus of our attention should be on what is permanent, what doesn't change. That's what truth is the unchanging. So Augustine says, well, that's exactly what evil is. Evil is focusing on things of this world instead of focusing on that next world, right? That next world where things are perfect and never change. So if you're familiar with Christian theology, consider what the Christian position is on worldly or earthly things. Right, these things are a distraction. They're a distraction from what's really important, which is that spiritual life or that spiritual self. Right? Don't focus on perfecting your physical body. You should focus on perfecting the soul, right? And why? Because the soul is that part of you that's permanent, that never that that is the ultimate truth of you, right? So again, this conception of evil is a very Platonic conception. And interestingly enough, right, the Augustinian position on evil leads to the growth of a group within Christianity called the ascetics, ascetics, and they essentially take the position that they should deny themselves all worldly goods in favor of their spiritual walk, and so they essentially, it would be like if you just stood up and walked out to the street and gave up all of your worldly possessions in order to follow God. That would be the ascetic position. And notice how it's an outgrowth of this idea that those worldly things, those things in this reality, simply get in the way of your larger goal, which should be communion with that spiritual world. So there's much more to Augustine, but for our purposes, that's what's significant, is his connection to, or the way he attempts to bridge this gap between Platonic ideas, the ideas of an ancient pagan Greek, and early Christian theology, and even up through the current time in Christianity, we see these ideas remain. Okay, so next, Saint Thomas, he is doing the same work as Augustine. The only difference is Aquinas wants to integrate the ideas of Aristotle into Christian theology, or find a way to bring them together. Because at this time, at the time of Aquinas, Christianity is very Platonic in nature. These fundamentally Platonic ideas have charted the course for Christianity. So at this time, the time of Aquinas, we see those ideas of Aristotle coming back into the fore, and again, conflict between Aristotle and Plato, but played out in Christian theology. So Aquinas, differently than Augustine, very, very religious for his lifetime. Famous for his hair shirt. Hair shirts, if you're not familiar, you would take a really coarse animal hair and you would make a vest like this out of that animal hair, and you would wear it under your clothing, and it would all day constantly scratch at your skin, as a kind of reminder that your attention should be focused, not on the physical, right, but on that spiritual walk, that the physical, it needs to be turned away from. Okay, so fundamentally, when we talked about Aristotle, the focus for Aristotle is on this idea of telos, right? That there are goals and purposes, and everything has a telos, has a goal or a purpose. So, in the same way that Aristotle thought that truth could be found in our world, Aquinas says, okay, how can that be? How can that be the case, right? Aren't we supposed to turn away from this reality? And that's the religious position, is to deny the things of this world in favor of that other world. And so how does Aquinas get around this seemingly fundamental difficulty? He does so by arguing that, human beings have the capacity to reason, right? And how did we get the capacity to reason? God endowed us with this ability to think rationally. And then when Aquinas looks out on the world and he thinks, okay, how did everything in this world get here? And of course his answer is that, well, God, right? God organized all of this. God put all of this stuff in place. So for him, if he uses his God-given talent to investigate the world that God has created, that there couldn't be a contradiction, right? That for him, that was absolutely in line with what he imagined Christianity to be. So Aquinas essentially sets out to prove what he believes by faith, utilizing the tools of philosophy. And by tools of philosophy, we simply mean reason, rationality, logic. And so by the time we get to the end here, we'll see some of his logical arguments, his syllogisms in favor of the existence of God. Basically, we'll look at a couple of his arguments for God. One other important aspect of the impact of Aquinas on Christian theology, and Aristotle for that matter, via Aquinas, is this idea of natural law theory. So recall, Aristotle and Aquinas argue that there are purposes out there in nature, right, in reality. We see things achieving goals. For Aristotle, the human goal, of course, was eudaimonia, right? So Aquinas says, in the same way, right, everything has a telos. The difference here, right, or what's significant about Aquinas is that he's going to argue that those goals are purposes, right? The telos out there in the world are divinely inspired goals and purposes that God has structured things in nature to achieve these goals, these purposes. So, for Aquinas, our actions, when our actions align with the way things are, or the way things, let's see, when our actions align themselves with the natural goal or telos, that is when we are acting ethically or morally, right? So, the example here at the bottom, right? That the acorn has a telos, right? To become the tree, right? And so, meddling, human meddling in the acorn getting to that eventual goal, or the acorn achieving its telos, that would be wrong. So in the same sense, we can see, if you look at certain things that humans do, that Aquinas is going to argue, or natural law theorists argue, that these things have a telos, a goal or a purpose, which would be reproduction. And to intervene and prevent that particular act from having its divinely inspired telos achieved is morally incorrect. It's unethical. It's wrong because it's contrary to the divinely inspired purpose of those acts, right? Just as the acorn's divinely inspired purpose is to become a tree, certain human acts are contrary to the divine telos. So, something like lying, right? Not representing the truth of things. Just as Aristotle argued that lying is always wrong, or adultery also always wrong, Aquinas is going to make those same arguments, right? That they're wrong because they're contrary to the natural order of things. They're contrary to the reality of things in the world, that basically things are this way, therefore things should be that way. Right, so murder is wrong because the natural position of humans is to be alive, right? That your life has a purpose and a goal, and for someone to intervene or to prevent you from achieving or fulfilling your goal or purpose, that is immoral, that's wrong. Always. Right? So natural law theory, essentially, because things have a natural telos, and for Aquinas, a divinely inspired telos, those actions that align themselves with that goal are the moral actions. All right, now let's look at some of his arguments for the existence of God. Now, Aquinas called these his five ways. We're just going to look at two of his ways, and then scholars later titled them differently. So this is known as the cosmological argument. Aquinas called it his second way. Some also call it the argument from efficient causes. Any of those is fine. Really, most folks now probably just talk about it as the cosmological argument. Okay. So you can read it here but I'll just give you a brief rundown of what he intends here. All right, so he's going to argue that the universe is a series of cause and effect relationships. Right, so we see, you know, everything has a cause, and that effect, as a result of that cause, becomes a cause, which has an effect, which becomes a cause. You know, think of it as a very long line of dominoes, right? You put, you know, one falls over and the one after it falls. And so the entire universe is composed of these cause and effect relationships. And Aquinas says, okay, you have two options here. Either those cause and effect relationships are infinite, right? They're no beginning and no end. Or there is a first cause, right? That this is essentially something, a domino that fell first, right? And so Aquinas says, okay, if they're infinite, then there's no first cause. And if there's no first cause, there's no second cause. And no third cause, and no fourth cause, and no fifth cause, and eventually no you, right? Or no now. But one thing you're pretty certain of is that you exist. Right, so Aquinas says, well, then there must be a first cause. And that first cause is God. Right, this is Aristotle's unmoved mover. Right, there must be something that is not caused by something else that must push over that first domino. The second argument we'll look at is called the teleological argument. It's his fifth way. Sometimes it's the design argument. But again, we're back to telos, right? So Aquinas says, in nature, we see things achieving goals, right? So the acorn becomes a tree, right? But acorns are dumb, right? So if you look at something else that is dumb, like an arrow, right? And an arrow reaches its target. Well, how does an arrow reach its target? Well, in order for the arrow to reach its target, there must be some intervention by an intelligence, right? And so, for the acorn to become the tree, there must be some intelligence that intervenes to cause that acorn to achieve its goal. And so Aquinas says, well, the intelligence that does that is God. The design argument, similar, right? That essentially the design argument goes like this. Have you ever seen how complicated the human eye is? Right? And you're like, yes, yeah, super complicated, right? What are the chances, right? What are the chances that all of those different pieces that make sight possible, what are the chances that they all simply came together accidentally? And you're like, well, chances are pretty low, really. And they say, well, exactly, right? Something must have brought those pieces together in order for sight to occur. So it's kind of like if you took a piece of iron and a piece of wood and you set it on the floor, how long before that becomes a hammer? And you're like, that will never become a hammer? I'm like, yes, right? In order for that to become a hammer, there must be some intelligence to bring those components together. And that's essentially, right, that the design argument, the intelligent design argument, is fundamentally the fifth way of Aquinas. It is the teleological argument. So I think it's interesting to note how old this argument is, that even in 2017, you know, that this is still a topic of debate. It shows you what an impact not only Aquinas had on Christianity, but what an impact Aristotle has had on Christianity. So again, both Augustine and Aquinas are working to end the conflict between the ideas of the ancient Greeks and Christian theology. Augustine brings in Plato, and Aquinas works with Aristotle.